Can you say it?
Your Honour and Commissioners, we have Dr. Thomas Doyle giving evidence this morning.
Your microphone probably needs adjusting. Dr. Doyle, is it?
Yes.
Doctor, it's necessary for you to be sworn. Will you take an oath on the Bible?
Certainly.
There's a Bible there. If you take it in your hand and stand for me and repeat after me, I swear by Almighty God.
I swear by Almighty God.
That the evidence I shall give to this Royal Commission.
That the information I shall give to this Royal Commission.
Shall be the truth.
Shall be the truth.
The whole truth.
The whole truth.
And nothing but the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
Thank you. Take a seat. Yes, Miss Smith.
Your full name, Dr. Doyle?
Good morning.
Would you tell us your full name?
My full name is Thomas Patrick Michael Doyle.
And what current work are you doing in the Catholic Church, Doctor?
I don't do anything for the institutional Catholic Church. The ministry, if you want to call it that, that I do almost exclusively is in two areas. One is with the victims and survivors and their families of sexual abuse. There's a variety of things I do there, and I'm also a licensed addictions therapist, and so I do some work, not a great deal, with families who have children that are into drugs back in my area.
Thank you. Now, you entered the Dominican novitiate in about 1964.
If you say so, I agree with it.
If I say so, based on your CV, would you agree with it particularly?
It's probably, I think it is 64.
Now, prior to entering that novitiate, did you come from a religious family?
My family, we were practicing Catholics, but we weren't churchy, so to speak. We weren't, my father was a scientist, and so there was, I think, a healthy amount of skepticism and realism in the family. We were not what would be considered at that time to be a devout family.
What attracted you to the Dominicans?
What attracted me to the Dominicans? I, at that time, by the way, I just want to say that the priesthood back in the 60s was an honorable profession, and it was one that a lot of us, you know, thought about. Had not been subjected to any significant criticism, at least, that most of us knew about. So I was attracted to the Dominicans because I was sort of thinking about becoming a priest, and I had met some, and I was very impressed with two things about them. One, they were very much down to earth and normal. And two, they were did a lot of college educational work, research work, and I was interested in that dimension. I wasn't too interested in being a parish priest.
And you took your vows in 1968?
Final vows in 68.
What did you do after that?
After that, I, in a religious order, most of them, you take your vows during the course of your formation, but ordination, if you're if you're going to be a priest, takes place separate from that. And you have to have final vows or solemn vows in order to be ordained. So I went back and completed, actually after 68, I began my theological studies, and at the end of those, I was ordained a priest.
And the theological studies you undertook where?
I did my theology in Dubuque, Iowa. We had our seminary of theology was in Dubuque, Iowa. And that's where I did it.
You ultimately did a PhD?
I beg your pardon?
You ultimately did a PhD?
In canon law.
In canon law.
Yes.
When was that?
I received my doctorate in 1978 from Catholic University of America.
And as you know, Doctor, we'll be dealing with canon law later, and you'll be joining us later for a discussion on canon law.
Yes, ma'am, I do.
Thank you. Now, you refer to, in 1981, being asked to serve as Secretary Canonist at the Vatican Embassy in Washington, D.C.?
Yes.
How did that come about?
I, at the time, was working for the Archdiocese of Chicago as a judge in their ecclesiastical tribunal. And I was called by my superior, the Dominican provincial, who informed me that I would soon be receiving a telephone call from the papal nuncio's office asking me to go out for an interview. And he said, if they offer you the job, take it. They did, and I did.
And what was the job?
The job was to work at the papal nunciature in Washington, D.C., as a staff canonist, and my main duty was to manage the process whereby candidates for the office of bishop are investigated, whereby dioceses are created, bishops are changed, transferred, or retired. I handled all of the administrative dimension of that.
What investigations did you do into potential bishops?
We would get the names of potential bishops. Let's say a bishop wants an auxiliary, an assistant. He would send us three possible names, and then we would look in our own lists of candidates that were there, possible candidates, and we would send out questionnaires, confidential questionnaires, to about 20 or 25 people. Some names provided by the bishop, others that we found, classmates, others, people he, the bishop, the candidates had worked under. They would all come back, and these were very comprehensive questionnaires, several pages long with maybe 40 or 50 questions. And at this time, at that time, Pope John Paul II was the pope, and there were several key questions that had to be answered affirmatively. One was complete adherence to the church's doctrine on sexual morality, complete adherence to the church's doctrine on marriage of priests, women priests, and homosexuality. If you didn't pass that, you didn't get any further.
And when you say if you didn't pass it, do you mean if somebody who was answering the survey indicated that the auxiliary priest or potential auxiliary priest didn't meet one or more of those criteria?
Yeah, that's correct, exactly. If we received, and all of this was done in deep secrecy, recipients were given an envelope that said, once you open this, you're under the pontifical secret and you cannot reveal the contents to anyone. And when they were done, they were to send the envelope, everything we sent them, they had to send it back. So there were no traces. But if they did reveal that, I'll just give you an example. One man wrote in that he knew this candidate quite well. And they were sitting in an airport waiting for a plane one day. And he said, we just got into a discussion, and I said, don't you think someday the church is going to give official approval to birth control? Well, that ended the candidacy of that particular individual.
And was there any discretion in you as to whether or not, given the other circumstances of the man's candidature, he should still nevertheless be accepted?
The only discretion I had was when I would discuss the results of the questionnaires coming in with the papal nuncio. He would want to know how the investigation was going, and I would bring up certain issues that had come up in some of the responses, and we'd discuss them. And if I was able to convince him that there's other factors here that are far more powerful and will make him a really good bishop other than a few of these things, which are just speculative, and are minor, and it's not that important.
Was part of the survey to ask whether there are any complaints or anything else adverse known to the potential bishop?
Yes, there were. And if something was mentioned in the area of sexuality, and if it was what we would generally do, would try to verify it to make sure that it wasn't a disgruntled somebody writing in to do the guy in. And we would have to verify it with the bishop of the diocese that was requesting the auxiliary bishop, for example. And if he said, well, I didn't know anything about that, and if it was nebulous, we would err on the side of caution and we would terminate that candidacy.
Was this process only for auxiliary bishops?
No, ma'am. The process was for anyone who was going to be consecrated a bishop. It was also done for bishops who were being promoted or changed from one diocese to another. The questions were slightly different. If a man, let's say, in Canberra is going to be promoted to Sydney, the questions were somewhat different, but we still had to look at his suitability for what they called higher responsibilities in the church.
Was the bishop from where the person came required to give something like a certificate of good standing?
Yes. The bishop who promoted, who put the man's name forward, would also put forward his curriculum vitae, as well as a report on his suitability. So that would be, he's voting for this man, and this is what we have, and then we would go from there.
That procedure wasn't set down in canon law, was it?
No, it's not. The only thing canon law does is say they have to be investigated and suitable. The guidelines we used were essentially guidelines we had received from the Congregation for Bishops in Rome. They were the ones, after our process was finished, it was all sent to the congregation, and then they would do another investigation. And if they found something over there that we did not find, or if someone on the congregation didn't happen to like the particular candidate, it would end there.
From your work internationally, are you able to help us with whether that form of investigation is done elsewhere or was done elsewhere?
Yes, ma'am. That type of investigation is done throughout the world. There are some differences. For most of the world, the process is worked through the Congregation for Bishops.
In Rome.
In Rome. When they finish the process with the candidates, and they decide, it's always three candidates are sent over, what they call a terna. And if they decide the first candidate is the one we're going to promote and propose to the Pope, the prefect of the congregation meets with the Pope once a week. And generally he said, I have all these candidates for the office of bishop. And the Pope would, under John Paul and under Benedict, would maybe look at a couple of them, sign off on a couple, and then he'd give a general approval of all the rest. Because there's no way he could have known them all.
The investigation was done locally prior to it going to Rome?
Yes. Everything locally had to be completed, synthesized, analyzed, and a report completed with the papal nuncio's opinion. I would have to prepare why each candidate was suitable for the office of bishop. If the nuncio liked what I prepared, he'd sign off on it. If he wanted changes, I would prepare changes. That went to the Vatican.
So the material that you sent out to, effectively, the referees, was sent back to you. What did you do with it?
The material from
the surveys, the completed
the surveys. I would go through them, and I would...
But physically, where did you put them?
Where did I put them? Mm. Every candidate had his own file, and the files were... The whole bottom floor of the nunciature was a huge archive, and it had files down there going back to the time of Pope John the 23rd. Everything before that had been taken to Rome. So we put them there. And if the candidate never got anywhere, if he was never promoted, or if it wasn't the right time, the files remained there.
And were the files covered by the pontifical secret?
Yes, ma'am.
Did the files go to Rome?
Eventually, they would go to Rome. Whenever Rome decided they wanted the files from that particular nunciature to go to Rome.
Now, that was the work you were doing in 1985 when you began that position?
I began there in 1981, and I was doing that throughout. But with the way it worked is the staff members did whatever the nuncio wanted us to do. For example, somebody would send him a book in the mail, and he would give me the book and say, read the book and give me a little report. Okay.
When was it that you first came into touch with victims or survivors of clergy sexual abuse?
My first contact with actual survivors was in 1985. That was not my first contact with the problem at the nunciature. But my first contact with survivors was in Louisiana in 1985.
What was your contact at the with the nuncio in relation to sexual abuse of children?
My first contact with the issue at the nunciature was, it involved two bishops. We were notified in one instance by law enforcement that a bishop had been picked up, a retired bishop, with a couple teenage boys. And rather than go any further, the law enforcement agency brought it to the papal ambassador, who in turn called the sitting bishop in the diocese where this retired bishop was living. And he went and saw him and talked to him and called us back and said, everything's fine. Except it wasn't fine, because a few months later, the same bishop got caught again. And this time, law enforcement agency said, we'll cover this time, but there better not be a third, because then we're going to have to do something official. Well, there was a third, and then not long after the third time happened, the bishop died of a heart attack. And the second instance involved a letter that we had received relative to the appointment of a bishop in a diocese in Pennsylvania. The Diocese of Harrisburg had come open, and the same thing probably happens here in the church among priests. There's always rumors going all over who the next bishop is going to be. Well, there were a lot of rumors about who the bishop was going to be, and we received a letter from a man in Long Island who said, I am a former priest, I'm laicized, I'm legally married, and my wife's nephew was sexually abused by one of the men who's being talked about to be the bishop of Harrisburg. And if he, in fact, is appointed bishop of Harrisburg, I am going to go public with this information. And the papal nuncio asked me if I would arrange to have an investigation done. This was my very first contact with more than just pushing papers. So we found a priest in the Washington, D.C. area that I had known for years, who was a very fine man. And he drove up to visit the family and talk to the young man and talk to the family. And he came back and he came into my office and he was going to give me his report. And his report was fairly short. I looked at him and I said, Bernie, what do you think? He said, I think he did it. And that was the end of that. I informed the papal nuncio, and the man was in fact under consideration, but that ended that.
Was there any talk about going to the police?
No, none whatsoever.
Was that something that was done in those days?
The event had happened maybe, I don't know how many years before this. I never got much information as to where it happened or when it happened, but I'll have to be honest and tell you, at that time in the papal ambassador's office, going to the police, unless they brought the case to us, was not even on the table. That was not discussed.
Why not?
I think it was not discussed because to go to the police would be A, acknowledge the reality of what had happened, and B, it would cause embarrassment for the institution. And the buzzword for that is scandal, which means embarrassment for the hierarchy, embarrassment for the institutional church.
So that was the beginning of your involvement with this issue in Washington?
That was my first encounter. Both of those things happened in 1982. But my real involvement, that when it happened, I knew that this was not going to end, was involved the case of a priest from the Diocese of Lafayette, Louisiana. Louisiana is one of the southern states, very south. And this priest had been reported and pulled offline by the bishop because he had sexually abused a lot of... He was a true pedophile. All of his victims were prepubescent little boys. He had been doing this, we later discovered since before ordination. But after ordination, which was in 1972, his first assault of a young boy after ordination took place in the kitchen of the rectory where he was assigned, probably within 3 weeks of his ordination. He had been reported to the bishop maybe, I think, five or six times, and each time he was moved to another area. What finally brought it to a head was the father of one of the victims in one of the rural parishes he was at, took a shotgun and went to the home of one of his friends and said, I'm going over to take care of Monsignor so-and-so. Do you want to come along? And he was fully intent on shooting this man, the pastor. So that word got back to the diocese, and they decided maybe we should do something. So they pulled Father Gay, his name was Gote, they pulled him offline and sent him to a place called the House of Affirmation. And at that point, the diocese entered into, they were approached, they knew there were, I believe, nine families that had been after them constantly. So they entered into an agreement with these nine families that involved total confidentiality on their part and a payment of approximately $300,000 per family on the part of the diocese. Now, this was the first time that I know of that something like that happened.
It was an awful lot of money in 1992.
It was a lot of money at that time, but there was a lot at stake at that time, and they realized it. One of the families, however, and let me backtrack. When that happened, the vicar general of the diocese wrote a letter to the papal nuncio, and he explained that we've entered into an agreement with these families because this priest had done inappropriate things with their children, and it's all taken care of. Don't worry about a thing. So the papal nuncio read the letter at our staff meeting, gave it to me, and said, prepare a response and put it in a file, which I dutifully did. Mm-hmm. 2 days later, we received another letter from the same vicar general who said, in a sense, never mind, because one of the families has pulled out of the agreement. They have engaged the services of a very brilliant, a very aggressive anti-Catholic lawyer. And the man was an anti-Catholic lawyer because he had been excommunicated by a former bishop for representing divorced people in divorce cases. So he was with his family, and they were going to sue the diocese. And they named in the suit the diocese, the bishop, the vicar general, the priest, the pastor, the papal nuncio, and the pope. When that happened, of course, it was public knowledge all of a sudden. The district attorney in the area, which would be, I think, the equivalent of a crown attorney here, maybe, realized that these events were all of them within statute of limitations. And he had to file criminal charges against the priest. That's when the media got involved. And the media, unlike in the past, where anything involving a priest of this nature was buried at the bottom of column 6 on the women's page, this time it was different. It was on the front page with pictures, and it went viral. There was a picture of this priest in his jail cell that was in Newsweek magazine, and so it was worldwide. And that actually begun, that's how I got started. And I was in charge of handling the case, preparing documentation, keeping my boss informed as to what was going on, because the nuncio was blown away. He didn't know what this was all. He knew what it was about, but he was just stunned when he found out that these people were going to sue the Catholic Church and that the media was pointing at the bishops and blaming them.
What were your writing instructions when you were handling the case?
My instructions were simply to prepare information for the letters that had to be signed by the apostolic nuncio to the bishop in the diocese. One of the things I did was I realized that they needed some professional help dealing with the accused priest. So I connected the bishop up with a man named Father Michael Peterson, who was also a psychiatrist who had founded a place called St. Luke Institute, which was and still is a healthcare facility for priests dealing with substance abuse issues and psychosexual issues. Peterson went and interviewed the man, tested him, wanted to find out what was going on. And he said that we got to bring him up to my place and give him a full battery of tests for about a week. And then he's got to go back into a lockdown situation. And in fact, by then they had him in jail.
Were his faculties taken from him?
His faculties were taken from him. To my knowledge, he has not yet been officially laicized.
Do you know why not?
I don't know.
He was ultimately convicted and jailed?
He was ultimately convicted. He was sentenced to 20 years and he got out after 10. He moved to a small house in East Texas and next door to a woman who had a 3-year-old son. And he was picked up for sexually abusing the 3-year-old son and thrown in jail. He was in jail for about a year, but the woman didn't want to go forward because she didn't want to get on the stand and she didn't want her child exposed. So he got out of jail for a while. Then he was picked up again for failure to report because he was on a sexual registry. And to my knowledge now, he has 2 types of cancer, and he's living alone in a small house near Houston, Texas.
Did the church continue to support him financially after he got out of jail the first time?
I think they did for a while.
Did they take any responsibility for supervising him?
No.
Is that something the church does now?
Well, they say they do. But the supervision, from my experience, now, let me just backtrack and say, I have been involved directly with this issue for 33 years. I've been involved in actual cases in a number of ways throughout the United States and in several other countries. So I've seen the promises that Father will be under strict supervision. He'll have three men who will be his support team. Sometimes that is actually done. I know of a few cases where it actually is done the right way. But for the most part, oftentimes you find that the men on the support team don't even know they're there. And this all comes out when the man reoffends. And so in general, I think you cannot presume that the supervision will be done in a competent, effective manner.
Just coming back to the role of the nuncio, was his role in relation to liaising in some way with Rome, or was it more of a local role?
His role was liaising with Rome. He functioned as a regular ambassador. He had really no actual authority in his office, only what might have been given to him. So it was mostly liaising with Rome, which he did significantly as we went through this. I was asked, I was tasked to prepare a report that he would sign and send to the Pope in February of 1985.
Just let me stop you there for a moment. So you understood the purpose of your work was to inform the nuncio, who in turn would inform Rome.
My job, that's exactly right. Inform the nuncio, liaise with the diocese, see what they were doing, and keep a file, a record of everything.
When you say liaise with the diocese, did it involve any oversight or any discretion as to recommendations you might make to them?
What I did was connect them with this Father Peterson, and he was making recommendations as to the what they were going to do, the disposition of the priest. But another factor came into the play in very early January 1985. The attorney who the diocese had hired to defend the priest on the criminal charges called Father Peterson, the psychiatrist, whom he had been liaising with, and he said, I need to talk to this guy Doyle at the Vatican Embassy. It's very important. So he flew up from Louisiana, and on a freezing January morning, sat down with me in my office. I'd never met him before. He was very direct, and he always called me by my last name. Never Father, never Tom. Now he calls me Tom once in a while. But he said, Doyle, I want to tell you something. We got this one, I'm going to pretty much quote him. He said, we got this one guy, Gote, down there, under wraps. But the diocese is hiding about six others that are still roaming around and preying on children. Now, I'm worried about that for two reasons. One, I got three kids at home. And two, I'm not going to be able to construct a decent defense if this is going on and the jury finds out about it. What he wanted to do with Gote, the priest, was work out a deal with the court whereby he would be in custody. He'd be locked down, but at a special confinement center in southern Maryland that dealt only with sexual offenders, where they were actually studied by the sexual dysfunction of the sexual disorders clinic at Johns Hopkins University. That's what he wanted to have done. He wasn't trying to get him off the hook, because everybody knew the guy did it.
But why did it come to you? What power did you have in that area?
He knew I worked for the Vatican Embassy, and he wanted me to go to my boss, the Papal Nuncio, and tell him that this was going on, that these other men were down there, and that they knew about them. The church knew about them. So I did. And the Papal Nuncio, in the little meeting we had, Father Peterson, the psychiatrist, was in on the meeting. It all happened within 24 hours. And we told him what the information was that we had, and he called the bishop up, and he called the Archbishop of New Orleans, who's the provincial, and he said, I want the two of you up here within 5 days to meet with Father Doyle and Father Peterson to sort this out. So the two of them came up with their lawyers, and we confronted him with the fact that we knew about these people. They didn't know how we knew, and we told them, it doesn't matter how we know. something needs to be done right now. And the deal was that they would go back and inform that the bishop said they would take them offline. They would pull them in. We were too busy dealing with the one case to get in.
They would take them offline. That is the six or so priests they knew about.
Yeah, the ones they knew about, that we informed them about, that the bishop and the vicar general knew about, all of them, that they would take them out of ministry and put them on hold somewhere while they sorted out what they were going to do. Keep in mind, this was 1985. When up to that point, this had been going on all over the place, all over the United States, but it was done in a deeply secretive manner. Nobody found out, and these men were transferred somewhere else under the cloak of secrecy. And if they were discovered again, they were transferred again.
So you prepared a report in 1985?
Yes. I suggested to the Papal Nuncio that we ask the Holy See to allow us to send a bishop down there to sort this out, to make an investigation to find out what's going on. Because I've only given you a little bit of the chaos that was going on. I mean, there were prominent lay people involved trying to defend the church. They were threatening to burn down the newspaper and the TV stations because they were publicizing this. It was a mess. So he agreed, but he said we have to get the permission of the Pope, and that could take a while. So we'll short circuit this. He said, you prepare me a report in detail, and we will get it to the Pope as quickly as we can. So I did about a 42 or 44 page detailed graphic report, names, dates, places, what the guy actually did from the reports from the psychologists. The nuncio signed it without making a single change.
This is the one fellow.
Pardon?
Which are you talking about?
The one man. But we also mentioned that there were six others down there floating around, and that we also by January had heard information from two other dioceses where it was bubbling to the surface because of the publicity. So all of that went in there. In other words, basically saying there are credible reports of priests sexually abusing children right now, February 1985, from at least four dioceses in this country. The report was sent by courier to the Cardinal Archbishop of Philadelphia, Cardinal Kroll, who took it the next day to the Vatican. When he flew over, he gave it to the Pope, and he wired back that the Pope did read it and that the appointment of the bishop was made within 3 days.
So the bishop was appointed from within the United States?
Yes. His name was Quinn, A.J. Quinn. And to cut to the chase on him, he turned out to be part of the problem and not part of the solution, because he was trying to figure out how they were going to continue with the cover-up.
How was he chosen?
Pardon, ma'am?
How was he chosen?
I chose him because I was familiar with the bishops, because I would do the process on them. And I chose him for three reasons. First, he came out on the investigation squeaky clean, as we say. He had a doctorate in canon law. He had a civil law degree. And he also was a licensed pilot.
That was important.
So, well, I just threw that in because I am also. So he looked good on paper. And he came in, we briefed him for a day, and then off he went to Louisiana.
How did you find out that he was on the other side, as it were?
I found out when he came to me and tried to minimize what was going on and was telling me that they're doing the right thing down there, the bishop has got it under control, and I knew he didn't, because the lawyer that's representing this guy is calling me every day with reports. Now, this is a culture down there. They're Cajuns. They're all related to each other. And so this guy's getting all this information from his cousins and his aunts and uncles about what's really happening. And they had, one of them worked in the Chancery office. So she was making copies of documents and shooting them over to him, and he'd send them up to me. It was a crazy drama, but it was real. So all this was going on, and whenever I get this information, I feed it to my boss. Well, in the process, we received another report from an attorney down there who said, I'm representing Mrs. So-and-so, and I want you to know that we're going to file a suit because Father Albert, I forget his last name, had sexually abused all five daughters in her family. And she wants you to know that she's not going to the bishop or to the church. She's going directly to the court. This was 1985. So what they did with him, they told him to pack his bags and go to Holland because we don't have an extradition treaty with Holland. Now, you can't make this stuff up. It sounds bizarre. I know. It may sound somewhat humorous, and I have to admit that one of the only ways I could cope with this through the years is find some humor. Otherwise, I'd have gone totally mad.
So the work you were involved in broadened after these events?
Yes, it broadened fairly quickly because of the publicity. And what we learned was that the secular papers were now putting this in a prominent place. It was on TV in the secular papers. It wasn't being covered up. So in many instances, families where parents had heard these things from their children, where the children would try to explain what father had done, where they didn't believe them or didn't want to make a report, they were coming forward. And I believe it was by June of that year, we thought we had a huge number of reports, and it was about 42. Some would report directly to us. Some would report to a bishop who then would call us and want to know what to do.
It seems unusual, Doctor, that the Papal Nuncio's office, and you in particular, attracted all of these reports.
Unlike probably other embassies, in the United States, people write to the Papal Nuncio for a lot of things. If the priest on Sunday doesn't say the right kind of sermon or does something a little off kilter, they write to the Papal Nuncio.
Is it because there was the perception that indeed the Papal Nuncio had a supervisory role over bishops and priests in the States?
I think the perception was that it would get to the Pope. Many people thought that the Pope would be interested in their report. Not everybody reported to the nunciature. Many of these came from other bishops who would then report in, because it attracted a tremendous amount of interest from the American bishops because of the publicity. They were all talking about it. They were all worried about it.
Well, they would be worried from an asset protection point of view, wouldn't they?
That played into it significantly. Many of them, I must say, that I talked to, because they knew I was the canonist there, so they called me for a lot of things, and that was one of them, said, you know, we've heard that this existed, but we don't know what to do. The ones that did know what to do, namely cover it up and move them from one place to another, they didn't call to ask. I also found out at that time that some of the bishops, in my opinion, sincerely wanted to do the right thing. The blockage in the United States didn't come from the body of bishops. And remember, we have approximately 350 bishops in the United States. It came from the National Conference of Catholic Bishops, General Secretary, their administrative body at the top. They're the ones that didn't want anything to happen. And so they did the blocking.
So you had, I think you said 42 reports?
That's right.
You thought that was large at the time?
That was at the time you thought it was large.
And did they continue to come to you?
We continued to be made aware, because sometimes the people, we'd find out about it through the media, sometimes through other bishops, sometimes people, you know, other priests would write, that kind of thing. It was there were a number of them. We weren't dealing with individual cases. What my two colleagues and I did, though, as a result of this, I was spending a significant amount of time every day on this. And we decided that we would like to prepare some sort of a manual for the bishops so that they would have something to look at, because this is new for us and it's probably new for them. So we did. And in preparing this, I consulted, because I was dealing with bishops all the time, with several ones that I trusted and that I knew and that I liked. And I asked them...
Bishop Quinn, I take it.
Beg your pardon?
Not Bishop Quinn?
No, Quinn, I didn't. I consulted with a man who was a friend of mine, and two men who were friends of mine at the time. I knew before they were bishops. One was Cardinal Law. He was a bishop at the time. And the other was Bishop Tony Bevilacqua, who eventually became the Archbishop of Philadelphia. They said, set this thing up in a question and answer format. So we did. And it had sections on civil law, criminal law, insurance, pastoral care, canon law, and the medical part. And it had attached to it several articles that Father Peterson had selected on what pedophilia is, its incurability, the effect on the victims, the kind of treatments, modalities that are used. And this came out to be a grand total of about 140 pages. We finished it up. It was a like a free will offering, I guess, if you'd call it that. My boss, the nuncio, was very much in favor of the endeavor. All we wanted to do was give it to the National Conference of Bishops and ask them to circulate it among the bishops so they'd have something to use.
Did you get the approval of Rome to prepare it and then circulate it?
No, I got the approval of the Papal Nuncio. That's all we needed. It was not an official document. It was a pastoral aid, as they called it. Well, the National Conference of Bishops didn't want it. They made both public and private statements that everything in it they were aware of. They knew everything that was in it. And so they didn't want to do it. They didn't see any need to have it. So in any event, the three of us were very disappointed. We had meetings, a couple meetings with some high-ranking bishops to discuss disseminating this and where to go from there. And that all stopped because we were told it's not going anywhere, so you may as well forget about it. But we did, at our expense, have copies made of that document sent to every bishop in the United States. And we did that on December 8th, 1985. Some of them used it. Some of them just put it in the trash, I guess. I don't know.
Was it around this time that you started dealing with victims and their families?
Yes, it was. There weren't too many, but I met that up to that time, dealing with it was a serious, I knew it was a serious problem. But the victims were pieces of paper that I read. I read the descriptions, and they were pretty disturbing. But then I met a 10-year-old boy with his family. And when I looked into his face, I still see it. It was empty. And that moment changed my life. Parents were simple, good, decent people who could not comprehend why they were being treated the way they were by the church. They couldn't understand why this man had been shifted from one place to another, and nothing was done. I had no answers, and I couldn't. But that was the first of, I can't count the number of victims I've met. The youngest was that boy who was, I think, 10 or 11 at the time. The oldest was a woman who at the time was 91, who had waited until she was 88 or 89 to disclose what had happened to her when she was 12. And what prompted her to disclose was when her own daughter, at the age of 60, disclosed what had happened to her. The woman told me that because of what had happened to her, she never was able, she had three husbands, have a decent relationship. She said, I could never get rid of the anger or the shame or the guilt. And now because of what happened to my daughter, and it's out in the public, I feel I can talk about this.
So if she was 91 when you spoke to her, the abuse happened in the late 1800s, early 1900s?
This woman's abuse happened, I met her when I was stationed in Germany, so this would have been 2001 or two. And I don't remember exactly when it happened, but I did listen to her for the longest time. And she just unloaded. And I didn't want to question, discuss, parse it. I just listening. was painful enough for both of us.
What capacity were you talking to these people?
I was talking to them only in the capacity of someone who was interested in helping them. I had no official mandate from anyone. I felt that I was an active priest at the time, that that's what I should be doing, is reaching out as a pastor.
And from that time on, you spoke to thousands of survivors and their families?
Yes. I still have contact, but since then, I've met them individually in groups, contacted by phone. Many of them don't want to tell me who they are or didn't want to tell me who they were, but they wanted to talk. I was the only priest in the United States who was prominent, who was known to have stood up to the system, which is why I was exited out of the embassy in 1986.
When you say you were exited, you were sacked?
I was sacked. They do it in a very gentle fashion.
Sure they did.
I was told that my room, my office and my bedroom was going to be needed by another man who was coming. Well, I figured that out pretty quickly. You know, I wasn't born yesterday, so yeah.
And had you achieved a public profile by that time?
I didn't. I was never looking for anything like that. I did achieve somewhat of a profile because when this document that we had prepared, when the media got a hold of it, my name was on it. So they were calling me, they were calling the other two, the lawyer and the priest, the priest psychiatrist.
But you prepared that report with the approval of the nuncio, didn't you?
That's right.
And was he the one who sacked you?
I think they decided that there was too much heat and too much attention being given to this issue, and that it would be better to let it sort of... I was told several times, we don't air our dirty laundry, we take care of our problems in-house. I didn't want to do that.
Who's the they you're referring to?
The members, other members of the staff. The nuncio told me that if I wanted to have a career, I'd best change my interests elsewhere than that particular problem.
So where did you go after you exited?
I went to work for the military, at the time it was called the Military Vicariate, the diocese for the military in the United States. And I was with them for about 3 years, but in 86, I enlisted in the United States Air Force.
Did you do some work there in relation to people with addiction?
Yes, I did. I did work in the Air Force. I was a chaplain, and after I was certified as an addictions therapist, which was in 2000, then I did addiction work as well. I will say, if it's okay, I'm a recovering alcoholic. I have 25 years of sobriety. I was trained as a therapist, and I'm licensed, and I'm approved, I guess. And that work, or that reality, is something I've exchanged and shared with a lot of the victims, and it has helped me more than anything to have a rapport with some of these people.
What did you learn, Doctor, after talking to those thousands of people? Over the years, what did you learn from them?
From the victims? A couple things. Many things. But there was a unanimity about one is the profound spiritual damage that is done to victims who are from devout Catholic families and who are sexually, violated by a Catholic priest. And I will say that one of the massive holes in the Roman Catholic Church's approach to this issue still today is a failure to completely comprehend the depth of the spiritual damage that is done to the victims, to their families, especially their parents, to their friends, and to the community itself. And there seems to be no ability to even ask the proper questions. I've never seen anything coming out of the Holy See dealing with the spiritual damage. All I've seen is getting to go back to church, which is nuts. That's crazy. But I've not seen anything anywhere. I've seen a lot of people on you know, both priests and religious, who've tried to figure out how to deal with this and bringing aid and comfort and support to the victims. But as an institution, I've seen nothing.
You're on the Pontifical Commission, is that right?
Well, I'm not on the Pontifical Commission. That would be too much for the traffic to bear, to be honest with you. I was asked to be a consultant by two of the survivors who were on the commission. And they told me when they brought up to the attention of the full commission, which at the time was 17 people, including four clerics, there were a lot of raised eyebrows, but that the cardinal supported it. And so they voted me in unanimously. So I did. I met with some of them, and I've sent them information and communicated.
So this is the Pontifical Commission for the Protection of Minors.
That's right.
And you were approached to be a consultant to it.
That's right.
And it had to be agreed by, presumably, the majority of the commission for you to be a consultant.
That's correct.
When was this?
I think it took place maybe in about three years ago, perhaps. It was not long after they started up and got organized.
What were you to do as a consultant?
Well, the first thing I did, I met with a number of them in London, and they said, we're going to give you 2 days, and all we want to hear is everything you know about this, which
only
I did.
Only in 2 days?
Pardon?
Only in 2 days?
Only 2 days. Well, actually, it went over two, but I had to pick and choose, obviously. So I gave them what I thought were the key issues that they should know about this. The commission's focused on the care of the protection of minors, its present and future protection of minors. What I told them, I said, I'm going to give you the conclusion flat out right now before we do our 2 days. And if it's okay, I'll do it here. I'll Certainly. Tell you what it is. I said, the key issue is not the protection of minors today and tomorrow. The issue today for the church is the pastoral care and the support and the love of the hundreds of thousands of men and women who they have violated spiritually and physically over the years. The victims have to be taken care of. The victims, if there's one hole in all of the processes, the procedures, and the protocols that have been issued from the top down, it's proper care of the victims. Over the number of protocols and reports that I've read, promoted and created by different church entities, one of the things that I see hardly ever mentioned is something comprehensive about caring for the victims. It's not enough to say, give them money to go to psychologists.
What was the response to that?
They agreed. The people that were there, the lay people agreed. There were two survivors on the panel, and they said that was the main goal, was to convince the Holy See and convince the panel, the commission, that this is what's really important. Protecting children certainly is. That is doable. That we can do. We can set up all kinds of protocols. We can make sure they happen. We can fire bishops and priests if they don't make them happen. But what they don't know how to do and what they didn't know how to do was face the men and women who've already been harmed and deal with their anger, with their shame, with their guilt, with their disappointment. And there's a major fear, and this is what I've learned over the years, to sit down, if you're a church leader, across the table from some of these people, because they are going to have a lot to say. And there's a fear of dealing with the anger and the frustration that goes with it.
Have you seen any change as a result of that advice you gave?
On the part of the commission?
Well, on the part of Rome or the commission.
Well, I'm not sure if anything happened because of the advice I gave. I gave them a ton of information, including copies of documentaries that have been made over the past few years, the ones about sexual abuse. I gave them books, all of them, to read so that they would have a real, some of these people that were on it, all they knew was what little bit they might have read in the paper. They had no clue what this was really all about. And one of the women on the commission, she had been the Polish ambassador to the Holy See. She thought her job there was to kind of make the Vatican look good to the Polish people. And when some victims went and approached her to want to talk to her, she refused to see them. So there's something wrong with that picture. So I don't know if they took my advice. I do know that in the time they've been in existence, I think the most productive thing they've done was convince the Pope to create a law that made it against the law for bishops to be complicit or negligent in covering up those who sexually abuse children. Whether that will ever be applied in the canonical system is one question, but where it is very helpful is in the civil courts, because now there's an official statement that what we have been saying all along is wrong. Now the Pope says it's wrong, namely covering up and lying and being complicit with abusive bishops, enabling it to happen.
There was talk of a tribunal in relation to bishops.
That got scuttled. That was, at first, you know, I'd say in the first half hour that sounded like a good idea, but actually all it was another layer of bureaucracy that would allow them to prolong any accountability even further. And nobody, there was no, they just said there's going to be a tribunal, but there were no norms, no explanation, nothing about it. So it sunk.
But there's something that's set up, presumably, in its place.
Nothing was set up in its place because the Pope doesn't need a tribunal to fire a bishop. All he needs is somebody to give him the information. And he has done it. This Pope has done it. He's done what hasn't been done in history. He's actually laicized three or four bishops and made them go through the canonical process.
The structure, I thought, that was established after the tribunal was, as you say, scuttled, was related to misconducting priests, wasn't it?
The structure that they developed was basically dealing with the Holy See changed some of the laws dealing with the priests, the offending priests. But across the board, the focus, the main focus, has to be on why they did what they did and why they were allowed to do what they did and why they were allowed to continue to do what they did. Not, you mentioned Janis Joplin yesterday. The John Jay study, if I can divert into that just for a second. When that came out, the second version of it, the first one was valuable. It was somewhat like what you produced yesterday, statistics. The second one was titled Causes and Contexts, and what the hope was that this one is going to get into why this has happened. I was asked to go meet with them for 3 days, which I did, and I gave them, you know, the best pitch I could as to the foundational structural problems that influence how and why bishops and other superiors do what they do in relation to sexual abuse. When the report came out, they dealt not at all with the structural issues or reasons. They dealt with, I would say, relational issues, circumstantial issues in the socio-cultural environment. So they said that a lot of these abuse reports came from the 60s and 70s, so it must have been, you know, the acid rock and the sexual revolution. So if you listen to Janis Joplin, you went out and violated a kid. But then our questions, those of us, my colleagues and I said, well, they missed a major, major source of data, which is the data that comes forth from the court actions. Now, what do you do about all the priests that violated the kids in the 40s and the 50s? Are you going to nail Benny Goodman? Seriously, I mean, that's how shallow that report was, and it was roundly criticized.
Why was that report so shallow in that respect, do you think?
Why? Well, because the bishops didn't want them to get into it. They were telling them what to look at. They were reporting in every 6 weeks. And they didn't have freedom to do what they wanted to do. They were sociologists, so they would have needed theologians and canon lawyers to help them really look at the structure of the church, the meaning, and sociologists that were experts in the clerical culture. But they weren't. They didn't have any. It's John Jay College is a college for criminal justice.
Just coming back to the 60s, it has been said by a number of church leaders that, as you say, was the catalyst for a lot of sexual abuse. From the work you've done, particularly on the history, that's just not the case, is it?
Absolutely not. I think that's an excuse. It's not a reason. It's a way to deflect from the core issue. Two other gentlemen and I published a book, and you mentioned one the other day, one of the gentlemen up here, Richard Sipe, who is probably the world's foremost authority on clerical celibacy. Anyway, we published a book in 2006 called Sex, Priests, and Secret Codes. That was based on a huge report that I had done on prior notice. And I thought I would take a look at prior notice up to the maybe 40s or 50s, but I used my skills. I specialized in medieval law, so I used my skills and I just kept digging, and the bottom of the hole I dug into went back as far as 309 AD. Since that time, I've done considerable research, as has Kieran Tapsell, who will also be on deck later, into this issue to trace the church's own documentation. And so the paper trail, so to speak, is from official documents from the Catholic Church. And the first one we could find dates from the year approximately 98 AD. And it was a teaching document called the Didache, or the Teaching of the 12 Apostles, which was found in the late, mid-19th century as a scroll somewhere. Anyway, it was a document that was used by the infant church, which was not an organized church at all. It was people gathering in homes. But they had a moral code, and the second chapter said two things. One, that men shall not engage in sex with young boys. And B, nobody shall engage in illicit sex with anybody else, mainly males. Now, there were no clerics at the time. There was the leader of the community, who was probably at that time called a bishop. I'm not sure if the concept of priesthood came in at that or not. But anyway, the point was, in a culture, the Greco-Roman culture that allowed that type of behavior, they were saying, you cannot do this. So that was 98. 309 was the first actual council of Catholic bishops in southern Spain that enacted laws. They were called canons, and the reason canon law is called canon law is from a Greek word, canon, begins with what we call a K, which means a rule or a straight line. They enacted 81 canons at this meeting. And the majority of them dealt with sexual issues, including making it a canon against the canon law to engage in sex with minor boys. And those who did engage in sex with minor boys were denied communion even on their deathbed. There was another canon that said clerics, including priests and bishops and deacons, or deacons, priests and bishops, were forbidden to have illicit sex with women or boys, and if they did, they were denied communion on their deathbed. Pretty severe. From that time, I searched out and isolated documentation from various sources consistently and continually down to the present day. During periods of church history, sexual abuse of minors was not cloaked in deep secrecy. It was known. There were periods in the late Middle Ages and in the middle Ages when the church authorities collaborated with the secular authorities. They would defrock a priest and then turn him over to the secular authorities, who would apply the whatever the secular penalty was. There were also in my discoveries penalties imposed by the church itself. Very, very harsh. Imprisoning monks or priests in church prisons, putting them on bread and water, beating them, shaving their heads, making them walk around in sackcloth and ashes, things like that. Pretty gruesome stuff. But what it did show was that someone understood the seriousness of males violating young boys. They would not have reacted in such a violent way to the perpetrators had it not been a very serious crime. So there's a lot of documentation indicating that this was publicly known. I think the cloak of secrecy went down in the late 1900s, and it began with a number of decrees from Rome that any consideration of these cases had to be covered in deep, deep secrecy. And it's that secrecy remained both officially and culturally until the mid-80s.
Has it changed?
It's changed somewhat. There's been significant change because bodies like yourselves, the courts, the media, and the victims have forced the change. They forced the institutional church to do the right thing, whether they like to do it or not. Now, there's no consistency there, unfortunately, but they do. I mean, they have protocols that they have to report offenders to civil authorities. There's been a tremendous amount of pushback against that by a lot of the people in the Vatican. But nevertheless, it is, it's a major topic of conversation and something that's being simply put legislated. You have to do this.
When you say there are protocols that they have to report offenders to civil authorities, is that only where there is a law, a secular law, in the jurisdiction requiring them to do that?
No, I think the latest Vatican document, which goes back to 2010, said that they have to report it to civil authorities. I think, and I can double check, and when we get to canon law, I'll talk about that. But the Vatican, when the Irish bishops sent their protocol over, and when the Americans sent theirs over, both of them said mandatory reporting to civil authorities, and they were sent back for correction. And they were sent back because their primary concern was the priests, due process for the accused priests. And they did not want that included in those protocols.
As you say, that issue will be dealt with later. Just coming to the causal factors as you see them, Doctor, where would you like to start?
Well, I think, let me look at my notes just for a second, if I may.
Well, if it...
It'll only take a sec.
Certainly.
The causes. I believe the causes of why men sexually violate children, if they're children, they're pedophiles. That's a psychosexual disorder, and that's not my competence to discuss, as you know. The majority sexually involve themselves with young adolescent boys or girls. That can come from a variety of issues. But my concern throughout has not been that. I've been concerned about the effect of the clerical culture in, I don't want to use the word support, but enabling this. But my main concern has been the institutional systemic causes, why this has happened, why it has been covered up, why it has been lied about, why the victims have in many instances been turned into the enemy, why when the victims enter into the civil courts, they're pounded into the ground by the church's attorneys in many instances. And you had a classic example of that right here in Australia with the John Ellis case. It's based on a number of factors, I think, that aren't too complicated to understand. The first is the church's teaching on the meaning of the institutional church. By that I mean the external socio-political structures. It's based on the belief that God himself, through Jesus Christ, gave St. Peter a blueprint. He said, I'm founding my church, and as the church teaches in the canon law, it's hierarchical by design. Now, unfortunately, that the appeal to the veracity of that is to tradition, because there's nothing in Scripture that adequately explains that that statement, I give to you the kingdom, the keys to the loosen and hold, actually was said by Christ. There's nothing in church history that says Jesus Christ started a church as we know it. so the structure itself, over the years, has become sacrosanct because it is believed to be, or taught to be, the sole way to achieve eternal salvation, which is what happens on the other side. And I think one of the issues that has to be brought into this, that a lot of psychologists of religion talk about, is the fear of the unknown, which had a lot to do with the foundation of religion in the first place. It all came about. They couldn't understand thunder and lightning, so there must be somebody up there shooting at us. And so hence the concept of priesthood came about, and the concept of the holy man, the most revered man in the community, who will talk to these powers and give them our sacrifices. So the concept of the institutional church as the official entity through which Catholics receive salvation. And the pillars of that church, the church is built, excuse me, upon the bishops. It teaches that the bishops are the successors of the 12 apostles. And when they're consecrated and they're told, you are the successor of the apostles and so on, you are the teachers of the church, etc. And so every diocese is run by a bishop who is the representative of Christ in his diocese. So you have the great reverence toward this structure, and this must be protected at all costs, because if it goes, our way to ensure salvation goes. Now, attached to that are all the things to keep that structure going, which is sociocultural deference, respect of the community, and assets, commonly known as the patrimony, that's the money of the church. So the protection of this entity is of all-encompassing importance. And that means the bishops themselves must be protected at all costs, and must be protected from embarrassment, from being lowered in the esteem of the community, because if these things happen, the church itself, as a way to salvation, will be seriously tainted and lose its ability.
And what you've said there, Doctor, goes to the response of the institution to the incidents of child sexual assault being made public.
Exactly. The response, what I have noticed over my years of every other investigation that has been done into this, and by me, every other, I mean every other, including some done by church authorities, one of the main causal factors has been prioritizing the image, the power, the authority of the institutional church and the bishops over the welfare of the victims.
So in addition to that being part of the institutional response, how does that affect the fact of clergy and religious sexually abusing children?
That affects the effect of clergy and religious, those who sexually abuse children, in this way. When they're reported, we have to keep it secret, because if we don't keep it secret, it'll become known and it'll cause an embarrassment. So that was the motivation over the years. Now, I find it interesting that I read in the statement from the Truth and Justice Commission yesterday, the number of pages explaining about society wasn't aware of what sexual abuse was back in the 40s, and that whole argument. I've seen that many, many times. And my response is, well, if they didn't know how serious it was, they didn't know it was a problem, why has the church buried it in mountains of secrecy for so long and banished anybody that brought it forward publicly, if it's not that important, if nobody knew what it was, if it wasn't that serious? So it has affected the victims, because it's also affected them because once they are encountered, let's say, by church authorities, they're enjoined in as any way possible from ever going forward to lawyers, to the media, to making this known. And the means that have been used have been soft, trying to convince them, you wouldn't want to hurt the church, you wouldn't want to hurt the bishop. No, I wouldn't want to, you're very devout, yes, okay, so let's just keep this quiet, we'll take care of it, which has never happened. Up to and including, if you go forward, you will be excommunicated. So the point is, the stature, the image, the power is far more important than the welfare of the victim. And in the theology that I believe in, there's no office in the Catholic Church or anywhere else that is so important that it justifies sacrificing the welfare of one innocent child. Period.
How is it that structure creates an environment or a context which allows, permits, doesn't prevent religious and priests sexually abusing children?
Let me see if I understand your question. How does that structure create a context whereby it allows men to abuse children?
What you've just said to us, Doctor, is one of the factors in how the church responds and why the church responds to allegations. What I'm asking you is whether or not those factors also have a role to play in why priests and religious sexually abuse children.
Yes, they do. I believe they do for a number of reasons, but I'll give you the ones that I think are the two main ones. That concept of the church as the as a sociocultural reality in our life, as being all important, is grounded on the clerical subculture. Yesterday, I believe someone talked about clericalism and gave a definition of it. It's a virus that has infected the church or any church, whereby it is believed that the church men, the priests, the bishops, are in some form or way sacred and above ordinary people. And because of this sacredness, because of their importance, they must be held as more important and protected more. So when it enabled the priests, many of them, from doing this because they felt that they would be protected, that and they used this stature, this belief on the part of people that they were higher beings, oftentimes to seduce, to groom the victims, to lead them in. And the victims, they didn't know what they were getting into. They had no idea. I can't tell you how many have said, once Father, we thought it was a tremendous honor that he was picking me out, because he's a priest. He's on a pedestal. He's higher than others. And he's on that pedestal because this concept of the institutional church has built that pedestal for him. So he's up there, and it's easier, the seduction, the grooming takes place, and the priest can use that to control the victim, to scare the victim. Don't you tell anyone about this, or God will be angry. And many victims that I've talked to are totally, they're completely confused through all of this, because they're taught anything sexual is a mortal sin. Priests don't do sex. Priests don't do sin. He did this to me. It must be my fault. Why did he do it? Priests take the place of God, which is another crazy belief that a lot of people have, that he takes the place of God. So God is doing this to me. What did I do to offend God? All of this comes from this structure. You know, it doesn't come from the air. It doesn't come down like snowflakes. It comes from that structure, and the victims believe that. That concept also is what has protected the disclosure, where parents would be afraid to disclose that their child had been abused because they're intimidated oftentimes, because we don't want to hurt the church. If we hurt the church, if you hurt a priest, it's a heavy-duty sin, mortal sin. We can't take that chance. It's also enabled a lot of judges to look the other way when they had a man in front of them who should have been sent to jail but instead was sent home.
You will be aware, Doctor, that one topic, certainly before this Royal Commission and before other bodies that have considered these issues, is whether or not mandatory celibacy may have been a factor in relation to what we now know about the extent of claims in relation to child sexual abuse. What's your view on that?
Without going into it in depth, my view is that it is directly affected. I do agree with those who say it's hard to stretch it, that just because a man has assumed mandatory celibacy because he can't have a sexual outlet with age-appropriate people, he's going to turn to children. I don't agree with that, but I do agree that the grounding for celibacy, the training, the nurturing, and the formation for celibacy has prevented men from maturing sexually, emotionally, psychologically, in many ways, so that as what one priest psychologist said, what we've got out there is the best educated group of 14-year-olds in the country. And unfortunately, the traditional seminary training, which you heard about very eloquently yesterday, that's what it was. Intimacy was denigrated. And by intimacy, I mean male-female relationships were of a lower plane. Celibacy, virginity is higher. We were taught that. I never was taught that in the Dominicans, but it was the common teaching. So that means you're all of a sudden, once you take vows, you're above your parents in God's eyes. And a lot of us could never figure that one out. I mean, that was insulting. It's demeaning. So I think the formation for celibacy, the attitudes that are used to try to convince the individual, and celibacy also functions as a kind of clerical garb, which sets the man apart. And I never fully understood this until one day when I was in Florida at a base I was stationed, a young lady who had been, I saw her at the chapel, she was an Air Force member, came in to talk to me, and she wanted to become active in the chapel programs. We got into this conversation over coffee, and she said, "You guys, you priests, you must be really, really powerful and strong." I said, "Why?" "Because you never have sex, and you got to really be strong not to do that." And I thought about that, and that's the perception, that the power, the difference, the uniqueness is because of we give that up, supposedly. And that so the, but the other part of it that I've seen is the, to buy into celibacy, you've got to buy into the church's traditional, bizarre teaching on human sexuality, which says that it's only good for making other Catholic babies, but everything else is a mortal sin. And it's you only do it reluctantly at best. So a lot of the individuals, a lot of clerics, have a very stultified comprehension of human sexuality. And that plays in when they're unable to comprehend the damage that the sexual violation of a boy or a girl does to an individual. When they're unable to comprehend the damage that rape does to a woman, to an adult woman. Or what happens to a child. When the leadership, the bishops say, well, Father was passed by two psychiatrists, we're going to let him back in ministry. When that's all they can see is that he's passed, they don't comprehend what has happened to those victims. That's never going to go away. Never going to go away. That's soul murder. And sometimes those murdered souls stay dead.
On that note, Your Honor, convenient time.
We'll take the morning adjournment.